um 20 Uhr in Meitner. Das Vortragsthema, das wir jetzt hören werden, ist laut einer Antwort der Bundesregierung.
Okay, so I'll start. Welcome to the translation of the talk, What to do against digital violence against women by Anne Roth. She's an activist and she's talked about this issue and other issues quite a lot at the CCC already. And she works for the Left Party in Germany. Welcome.
Vielen Dank, schönen guten Abend.
Okay, thank you.
Ich kann euch original überhaupt nicht sehen, so richtig.
I can't see anyone in the audience. The only thing I see is like a very bright light. So,
ja, schön, dass ihr gekommen seid. Ich freue mich.
Please be patient with me. Thanks for coming here. Ich bin bei wahnsinnig vielen Talks gewesen. I'm happy everyone's here. So, I haven't been to many talks either, so I'm really glad that you are here. So, what to do against digital violence against women is today's topic. And this is not a question, but instead it's a statement. I talked about this topic at the last Congress. Some of the stuff that I'll talk about will be repetitions, but I'll talk about different stuff as well. So, if you've heard my talk before, great. If you're here for the first time, also great. What's digital violence? There's a group of people that are responsible for helping women in Germany. They say digital violence is all forms of violence that use technical tools or digital media, or that happens on online portals or social platforms. We assume that digital violence is not actually separate from analog violence, but instead is actually a continuation of relations and dynamics of violence before. Currently, there's talk about stalkerware. Stalkerware is software that we can also call spy apps that we would install on a mobile phone of other people, and they would basically log everything that's happening on these phones. And there's many of them happening, and this is a website that's older. And we can see what the marketing campaign here is. The goal is woman or maybe, you know, cheating girlfriends to survey these cheating girlfriends. Another example in German, how can I track my girlfriend's phone? This is the localization function. But localization isn't the only thing the stalkerware can do. This is a very very pressing example, for example. And what I find very interesting for this example is it's very obvious what we can see there. It's about domestic violence. He apparently hit her before, and this is marketed to this perpetrator, basically, so that he can watch whatever his victim does at any and all points. This is one example of digital violence, but there's other digital violence, and this is something that's been especially common in South Korea in 2018, which were protests against spy cams in South Korea. There's a screenshot of how small these cameras can be. So this is, in this case, it's in the screws of a toilet door. And basically, you can see, they're used to film or photograph women in not public but not private rooms, like public toilets, fitness studios, these kinds of things. In South Korea, 20,000 women actually protested against spy cam porn. Because these recordings aren't only used privately, but instead they're often sold and especially uploaded to the internet, where many users will be able to see it. Oftentimes you can even see the woman's faces. And that's not only like a fun joke, but for those that affected, that's a really, it's really, really uncomfortable because everyone can see them, and sometimes there's even their names there. The posters they're wearing are very, we can understand them. My life is not your porn. My body is not your porn.
Berichte darüber machen deutlich.
There's been other reports that kind of show how important this problem is.
Weine nicht, wir helfen.
In this tweet, don't cry, we'll help get you get the video deleted. We'll protect you. This kind of digital violence makes people actually kill themselves or want to kill themselves. On the right side, it's kind of very more funny. I want to shit with my guard down without having to be careful of who might take a video or a picture of me. And this is the same person that tweeted at the beginning. And this is what we've seen is that Korean women are wearing masks more and more because they do not want to be recognized if they're affected by spy cams.
Angebracht sind.
These on these pictures, all of these holes are cameras. Now these were just two examples, but there's many, many more examples. Like hate speech is basically the term we use in Germany usually.
Gemeint und Hate Speech ist ja auch nicht nur eben.
And hate speech isn't only defaming someone on the net, but it can go much further. There can be very real and very private and very personal consequences. For example, if it's connected to doxing, so if someone releases your addresses or your work address. But there's also a lot of other things that are also within this purview, like threats online, upskirting, which is kind of very well known currently, because in Spain someone was punished just now.
Veröffentlicht hat.
Because he had made pictures under the skirts of women. Currently in Germany, it's not illegal officially, so there's an initiative to make it illegal, but I think it is illegal actually right now. There's also kind of defamation and identity theft. So using pictures of a person, you can make a new social media account and post pictures or even take over an existing social media account with pictures. And this is something that happens quite a lot. There's like women's pictures that are put on pornographic pictures. Sometimes even with pictures, come visit me at home. And that's kind of like some people are actually showing up there in front of your door. And this is where digital violence becomes more analog and really visible. And the problem localization is often a problem of, especially in domestic violence. If a domestic violence perpetrator wants to find his former victim, he might be able to find them again after they have left. And revenge porn is also an example that we see sometimes in the media. Like if you have made some sort of porn videos together, just like, you know, willingly, because you're in a relationship at one point, and then you break up, and suddenly the perpetrator sends these private videos to family and friends, which is a very big burden on people, especially mentally. From a master's thesis by Jenny Carsten Bauer, who talked to consulting services for women, especially social workers. And these are kind of quotes that show how big this problem is. What I have often is spyware on iPods, mobile phones, and so on, where they can be located. And sometimes it's actually dangerous, especially if there's common kids, when the woman gets a new phone, so that he will not be able to follow her, the father will give the kid a new iPod. And sometimes there's perpetrators from childhood, and they stopped being in touch. Suddenly, it's like the uncle, the grandma, something. And they suddenly started defaming someone about like what kind of stories are they telling. Most of these examples, it's not strangers, but instead it's people that the woman know already, mostly ex-partners. And usually these were relationships that were dominated by domestic violence. Suddenly the woman leaves the relationship, goes out of his control, so to speak, and he tries to get control again. And that's what he's trying. And the internet is really ideal for that, because there's a lot of ways to get access again. Now this kind of domestic violence is really a lot about control again. Last week at the Usenet Security Conference at the US, there was a research project which I found very interesting, and I was very happy that it exists. Two people from US American universities are trying to find out what kind of digital violence are we seeing, but at the same time also trying to see how can we help there. And they have a fictitious example of a typical example, basically, of a typical person.
Mit dem die Frauenberatungsstellen dann zu tun.
Where a lot of these women's services are involved with.
Die sich von ihrem Ex-Mann.
This example is Carol, who separated herself from her ex-husband. There's been a history of physical, emotional, and also digital violence. They have, they're currently fighting over custody between, for two kids, and she knows that he installed spyware on at least one of her devices, because she saw it on a joint credit card statement. He had access to her private photos that he posted on Facebook. He hacked into her online accounts and tried to pose as her to further alienate her from her friends and family. And he locked her out of her Gmail account, which had actually problems, consequences in her job. Carol has five devices, an iPhone that is her primary device, two Android phones that are used by her children, and an iPad used by her children, and also a kind of older iPhone. She uses Facebook, Gmail, and other social media apps, and this example is really interesting to me because it shows how difficult it is. What is actually the problem? How can we make sure that this doesn't happen again? Because it's not only, oh, he has access to her email account, so, well, she can reset the password, but we don't even know what kind of attack vector does he have, how are they connected to each other, what can he do next? Then it's kind of very, very difficult to find out how to help this woman.
Wie sind die Auswirkungen auf die Frauen?
So what's are the results of this citation by Ulrike Lemke doing this for Böll Foundation, in a study looking at the police possibilities to help. The bullying has a lot of psychological and physical illnesses, psychosomatic illnesses, migraine, and so on, depression, suicide thoughts, people affected, go away from their digital public, change their jobs and move to lose their environment and so on. And the study of the Canadian Citizen Lab from this year, looking at stalkerware and digital violence, in 85% of cases in the USA, technologies were used to localize the victims, 71% of perpetrators in domestic violence survey, computers of victims, 51% of perpetrators survey smartphones via smart stalkerware, 82% of the victims in Australia see threatening and defamation and so on via smartphone abuse. And 2013, and 72% of perpetrators hack email in the US, in Canada in 2012. In Germany, there are no real numbers, there's no statistics. There's a small question in the Saarland Landtag. And I asked colleagues to ask their Landes government to see what numbers they have, and all Saarland could do was analyze the police statistics and look at where internet was used in connection with certain laws that got broken. So we can look at it that concretely. We don't really know what happened or who was affected. This is from Saarland. Similarly, the Landes government from Mecklenburg-Vorpommern answered a bit longer ago. You can interpret a lot of things into this. The numbers go up and down. So we can have a talk about police statistics and how they work. So there's something, but there's not really something. There's an answer of the Landes government of Sachsen. You know, I like Sachsen. Sachsen didn't disappoint and did a nice answer. So we don't really have time to look at this. This would have taken far too long. The people have more important things to do, so we couldn't answer it. In Mecklenburg, the question was, what does the Landes government know with the numbers of women and men and their ages, and they said they don't know because in the statistics these numbers are not there, so they don't know. And then there's this, I was a bit baffled. The conference of equality and women's ministers, and senators of the Länder met in 2015 and looked at digital violence. They call it cyber violence and have some resolutions for that. It's 4 years ago. The year before that, there was already something like that. And they wanted things that are very similar to what I think we should do. So there needs to be more education for this topic. The GfMK, this is this conference, is asking the Ministry for Women, Family and so on to see if we can have a study to analyze this violence. They want this from 4 years ago. And they're saying that the police jobs have to be educated more to know how to handle these things, that the police has to be educated. And what I think is interesting compared to the answers above, they asked the conference of the ministers of interior to see if there's if they can have a statistic based on genders in the police statistics. And this is 4 years old. The federal government has done nothing about this. These questions have been there for years.
Hier nochmal die kleine Anfrage vom November. Das ist
another small question from November. In the Bundestag, does the federal government plan any studies to this? They say, yeah, we're doing something against right-wing extremism and Islamism, and this has something to do with gender, and that's it. That's the answer to the question. They don't say no. They just juggle a bit, study or something like that doesn't exist. Another one is digital violence against women, a phenomenon of cybercrime. And the answer is funny, but I think it's relevant because you can see what they think, how important this is. Cybercrime is just crime, which is somehow digital, so cybercrime. Why is digital violence not a cybercrime? I think that should be in there and should be taken serious, but it doesn't happen. The federal government has a quite small definition. Digital violence is not violence against the internet, data nets, information systems, or their data. If you read cybercrime, look at this definition. Everything else is no cybercrime. And we ask if the federal thing of information is looking into this, and they say no, this doesn't really have to do with information technologies and services. That's what the Federal Ministry of the Interior has to do. So the BSI doesn't really care about this, they don't really do anything about this. And gender stuff, that's just not their topic. I also thought it was interesting because the BSI has a platform for citizens affected with concrete tips for people in the internet, and I don't know why this topic shouldn't be covered by this. Federal government in November thought this is no problem, and then a lot of celebrities got doxxed in January. 6 weeks later, there's a press conference with Seehofer, the Minister of the Interior, and a lot of politicians got doxxed, and other people was a big thing. It was, I think, very, very smart to see this as a big thing because doxxing is not a small thing. And now it's cybercrime. And Seehofer talks about this a lot. This has to be fought against hard with this new IT safety law 2.0, which I don't think really does help any dox people, but has a lot of hack backdoors and surveillance and shit. So doing what the stuff they always do, but at least it's along doxing. And then in the organigram of BSI, I found in the corner a project group, digital consumer safety. If you know what this does, I would be very interested in it. And I thought, yeah, well, maybe something is happening here. What do you do against digital violence?
I
put this into small groups. Firstly, help and support the victims affected, because they're mostly alone with this. They don't really know who can help them. We need to talk about this more in public. It has to be a public discussion. Nobody's really talking about it right now. And we can see, even when there are no concrete numbers, this won't be smaller. It's a big problem. It affects a lot of people. So it's a pretty hard problem as well. We need to talk about this more, because this is an aspect of digitalization affecting a lot of people, and nobody is supporting them. So there has to be political solutions to this. coming from a discussion, because what exactly to do, and we don't really know, there's no recipe. What we need is technical support for counseling services. Like, these services are understaffed and underfunded, which is normal for sexual violence counseling, and but they don't really have the means to look at devices and so on, and they don't have the know-how. So coming back to the project from New York, the city of New York has staff, hackers on staff to get at this problem. And I think that's a very sensible cooperation. There, on one of the events, Eva Gelfrand from IFF has been talking about a stalker in the US, and Kaspersky is now covering stalker programs with their antivirus programs, and I think that's a very good way to do it. And I hope it will go on. And there are many ways of cooperation possible. And it's not as simple with three recipes to solve this problem. It's a bit complex. Where can victims go?
So the BFF, the group of people that are of like women counseling services, they have a project, but it's still kind of small. In Berlin, there's a anti-stalking project that kind of has this focuses on cyber stalking, but I don't know any other projects. Now, obviously, I don't know everything, but I would be happy if you could tell me more projects, but my impression is that there's not really a lot of support there. But what do people need actually? What do the victims affected actually need? First of all, we need to take them seriously. From their perspective, they don't really know what's happening. What does he know about me? Who will he show these pictures to? There's like a lot of stress, a lot of helplessness. Maybe it's not this big case, but smaller cases, but even they can cause a lot of stress. Now, obviously, we also need to be calm. And first of all, we need to kind of map the problem. What kind of devices do I have? What could he have access to? Like smart devices I haven't talked about, but that will be a problem in the future even more. So who at home is in charge of all the devices? Who set up all these smartphones and routers and stuff? And who has access to all of these, maybe remotely even? And how can we get the access back? And then maybe step by step, go to where we can kind of make it happen that they can't access it anymore. Second, if we have stalkerware, it's very difficult to see whether it's actually installed on there. A factory reset can happen there, can help there actually, but what is happening currently is that women are buying new phones all the time, which is very expensive, of course. And something that I haven't said anymore, but I hope that's self-evident. It's illegal, so you should really get in touch with a lawyer and sue someone, and maybe go to counseling services so that they will be able to put you in touch with the right person. What can politics and the public do? First of all, it's important to make it a topic and to make sure that it's not considered something small. So it's important that we expend more money for research and for studies. I hope there's more research and studies already, but I don't think there are at this point. So if you know anything about this, just let me know. no. It's also important to kind of even define the talk, even define the term. There's a lot of ambiguities, and there's a lot of potential for research. But we also need more money for the counseling services, and we need to educate our police, our justice system, and our lawyers. What we've seen is, like, if we have police or the justice system, they're sort of involved with anything with internet, and they don't know what to do. Suddenly, we don't really know. Now, some people say, oh, you should really go to the cybercrime justice departments that now exist, but they think you're not supposed to go to, like, we're not really in charge of all the women stuff. And then there's these departments that are focused on women stuff, and they don't really know anything about the technical side. So what can we as hackers do? First of all, we can do we can support these counseling services. Now, there's no ready-made concept that you can use, but maybe you can just go up to someone and in your own town and like how can and just ask them, how can I help you? And maybe at one point we will actually have some sort of large-scale solution, like have this sort of technical know-how that any counseling service could access then, because it changes every single month. And it's very, very difficult to just stay up to date. So maybe it would be important to have something like the Information Security Office in Germany for this problem as well. And what we also need to do is not to tolerate the perpetrators. I know that especially in sort of like these technical know-how communities like we are here, and someone might come up to you, I would like to know what my girlfriend does. And obviously you can't do that, and you should treat it the same way as analog sexual violence. You shouldn't support this kind of behavior. And lastly, we as hacker community, tech community, can't leave this discussion up to politics and the justice system, because what happens there is what we've seen before in the child porn issues, for example. They use these issues to get to these solutions that aren't actually useful. Sometimes because ministers of interior and the police like to get surveillance policies, but also sometimes because people that are involved with sexual violence, they're not really, they don't really know a lot about discussions around the internet. And they say, oh, well, we need a new law. We need to get rid of anonymity on the net. And if we don't want this to happen, then we need to be involved in the debate and have better ideas. And this is the end of my talk. Thank you. I'm excited for questions.
Thank you.
Vielen Dank.
Thanks.
Wir haben jetzt noch ein bisschen Zeit für
Fragen. We have some time for questions. A bit shorter than we wanted, but
es gibt keinen Signal Angel.
There's no Signal Angel. The internet can't ask questions. Please come forth.
Hier vorne bitte.
Was ich mich frage ist, warum
what I ask myself is why call this against women, this talk? Because it could get used against me as man or something. That's a question that happens at every topic. Why are you talking about this and not this? What about these people? What? Why only these people? I think this topic is very relevant and important. It's a big problem few people look at, and I think it's a very specific problem, because domestic violence as digital violence is not distributed equally. The largest amount of victims are women. This is why I started looking into this. This is why I'm looking into this topic. And yeah, of course, if more people went to this topic, it would be great, and they also should look at these questions.
Now,
this is not supposed to be a dialogue, so the next asker, please. You said these are crimes, and I would think they are mostly well documented if they're actually people actually do get sued. Do you think this isn't punished harshly enough, like other crimes, to scare people away? Where do you think the problem is? The question is good and correct, but it's not hitting it quite right, because there are a lot of different crimes, the whole bundle of laws that are relevant here. Defamation, stalking, threatening, doxing, and so on and so far. Like analogous injury, there are the hacker paragraphs to not manipulate other people's devices, prohibition to post private pictures publicly. There are a lot of laws employed here, hopefully. I don't know a lot of actual people doing it. The police says, "Oh, it was a picture. What's the problem?" Or there was a defamation on the net, but it wasn't a concrete threat. So the problem with hate speech, we all already know. There's the NetzDG, law in Germany. This is the first step. I don't think it's correct in every way, but in a lot of other areas we're still missing this, like picture manipulation, and nothing comes from this because it's not actually applicable to this specific paragraph or something. I want to connect to the first question. I think this is important because you said it's very well, but I don't think it's a specific women's problem. Don't you think men don't really need counseling as well? There's a lot of stalking where women stalk men, and the man has to go to police and gets laughed at. And I think specific picking women out of it, I can't make this work for me, because I think we shouldn't look at gender roles as much. So what's the question? No, it's more of a statement. Thanks.
Vielen Dank. Ich kann da im Grunde nichts
Thanks.
Anderes zu sagen,
als I can't add anything except what I already said. For me, this is a relevant topic. I'm repeating myself because domestic violence is not distributed equally. Thanks. I'm glad for everyone who's looking at different aspects of this topic. So why not?
Gut, ich sehe dann
Thanks.
Noch
I can see one more question, a last question. Thanks. Many thanks for your analysis and your talk. I want to know, you showed there are numbers in the US, there are almost no numbers in Germany. What about other countries who are more progressive about this, showing analyzing domestic violence more specifically? Yes, of course, there is a little bit. I would point at my talk from December, where I tried to analyze a bit more specifically. There's a study by Amnesty, where it's about harassment at Twitter. The European Human Rights Agency looked into it. There are a few things. There are links to this on my blog and on that on the page of that talk in December. If you write me, I can send you some more stuff and give you more information.
Eigentlich ist die Zeit.
Actually, the time is over. We have 2 minutes. Thanks, that's very nice. I'm asking myself if you're in a class of people, if you are there in front of a bunch of girls and boys and diverse people, what would be the first things you'd say to these people to. What they should watch out for, what they should talk about for. I'm not in school classes that much, so I don't really know. But I would say, which I guess a lot of teachers would also say, if they know about media stuff and smartphone usage and so on, think about who you show which pictures, think about if you want to be have an account with your full name online, look at the edit that you can't hack your accounts that easily. Password security is important. And the whole thing of bullying, which is often the start to something of this, happens a lot more, gets talked about a lot more. That's very important.
Vielleicht, wenn ich noch ganz kurz sagen kann, wer sich dafür interessiert.
Can say it very shortly. I have some brochures here by BFF, which is this counseling service study analysis group. Thanks, and thanks for the invitation to further discussion and